Auntie Susan. Thank you very much for the card and chocolate.
I had a lovely holiday with David and the Jessens.
His father has bought an old Humber, and we've been all over the place together while he sells his paper. David and I pass the time by telling stories and inventing all sorts of games. We invented a super one at Barley Hill, pretending to be shopkeepers and things like that.
His Uncle Peter told us they used to burn witches there. His Uncle Peter knows so many interesting things.
He lives in the woods near Bradfield, where the lights are. The ones I can see from the road.
Without Uncle Peter's tricks, the holiday wouldn't have been half as much fun. He let us explore in the woods, and I could see the lights through the trees.
Mr. Rabbit and wise old Mr. Owl. All the furs and the feathers and the eyes and the beaks. There's so much happening in the woods, and now I know where to look. Mr. Owl is so wise. We also went to see the stained glass windows at Martham.
They are very beautiful, Auntie.
Uncle Peter showed us when to go to best appreciate the colours, when the sun is at just the right point in the sky. It's fantastic. I really felt I could feel those colours. And I still have those colours in the corner of my room. It's been the most wonderful holiday, Auntie. I can't wait to see you at Christmas. Thank you again for the very generous present. With lots and lots of love, James.
Leave windows, leave walls, leave chairs, leave doors, leave buckled paths and habits, the sky on the ceiling, the horizon outside. Take this voice for your own, these words, this light, they are all like you. Fugitive. Your thoughts are found in the words of others now. Let the ear grasp what the eye lets slip. Only the voice unlocks the reflection from the mirror. Only the voice lets pictures exceed their own dead end. Every word and image is opaque. Moving through them, we illuminate each with an utterance of our own. Expand between vanishing points, what is so easily compressed in the present. What can only be felt in the shifting of channels, floods, and tides must now be spoken to life in rooms, costumes, and small delights. As these waters subside, what is made here will no longer be savaged by the current. What rises from these waters, what remains here, depends on you. But everything you see before you is your own. This house, these plains, this voice, these words. Walking amongst them, I will tell you of a life lived without you. You won't believe me, and neither will I.
We call our rover a Choti Si Asha, or Ika for short. Once we take off, it's about a 15-minute ride into low Earth orbit. The spacecraft then does two orbits around the Earth, raising the apogee, and then slingshot, and then go to the moon. Ika is kept completely quiet, semi-cocooned under the mothership.
She gets released from the lander.
And then she's dropped.
She falls 300 millimeters and touches the lunar surface.
Ika will be switched on only after she falls on the lunar surface and the sand settles down. One moon day is 14 Earth days. We intend to land close to dawn, and then she would begin her journey.
So she has to tread very carefully and very slowly.
Her first baby steps on the surface.
She's got two eyes in the front, which are basically high definition cameras. She clicks pictures of her surroundings. She tries to understand what's around her.
The main dangers that she would have is craters and mountains.
If in case she's stuck in a spot where slippages are very high, but she still tries to keep on rolling her wheels, she will just sink in. Then she has just a couple of hours to keep trying and wiggling out of that. But if that doesn't happen, we have to let go of her.
If she was to go beyond a range within which she can speak to the mothership, we would lose contact. Once you lose contact, because she's not autonomous, you can't bring her back.
Ika's being bombarded with heavy infrared and ultraviolet radiation. Heat gets conducted into her chassis, into her body, through her wheels.
Thank you. At the end of 14 days, when it becomes night on the moon,
when the sunlight starts failing,
is when Eva goes back to sleep and will be asleep for the rest of her life.
That would be the end of Eva.
Because we don't bring her back. We can't.
It would be like saying goodbye.
Sun suffocate the atmosphere, but I am safe with you far away from here. Another fire through another open door. This of mine be all that you need. It's not my trauma, broken nothing. Where another truth on your turned up sleeve. This is
everything. I'm Listen. In the time of our great-great-grandmothers, men drew the map for our town. These men lived in a great city, a six-month journey away by ship. The map was perfect. Every street, every church site and lane for housing, designed with the future in mind. When the men arrived, immigrants in this new country, which we call Aotearoa and they called New Zealand, their map did not fit the terrain. When they arrived, the landscape they had chosen from their faraway view in a London office turned out to be swampland. The land did not want to hold the weight of a new settlement. But the map was perfect, so instead, they drained the marshes and the streams to make the land fit the map. A stone city formed upon swampy foundations. In the time of my mother and hers, there was at first a trickle, then a great roaring river flowing back and forth of visions and flavors and sounds. And of people, and people, and people. They came here and we went there. They came here, and came here, and came here. In my time, the time of me and my sisters, we were thrown from our beds in the dark light before dawn. The earth shook, but we forgot to take cover. To hide under a desk, under a doorframe, under a table. The sound was too monstrous for thought, so we waited for the land to stop rolling beneath our feet as the silt belched up to our ankles and the city lurched back into swampland.
Thank you. Don't I stop. Don't go to the road. Come back.
I'm coming.
Okay. Just be careful. Don't take me. Can I have it, please? Pass it, please. Thank you.
In a circle, like guild or something.
Yeah.
Guild.
I'm gonna take this, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's cool, man. Do your thing.
Mama.
Hey, Tendai. Can you see me properly?
Just about.
Where are you?
In Paris. We're coming from church.
How was it?
The church was going to be joined. He was touching on some things that are happening to me. So I felt relieved. I felt better.
One of the latest messages
been. Have you gone to see what's it?
Andrew.
Yeah, Andrew.
Yeah, I spoke to Andrew and he just gave me like a brief update of what's going on. I just need to get a few, you know, documents and stuff. Then we could just really go for it. We can really just fight this, you know. So just please, just bear with me, man.
Mama,
okay.
A burden on you, and you need someone to support you or to strengthen you. Being all alone and trying to fight for me, you are doing really well, and I feel this is when I feel I was there. So I could be able to sort out this.
It's just hard, you know. It's just hard just without you there and stuff. I really miss you.
Oh, make me cry.
No, I really do.
You make me cry. I feel bad. I feel bad. I don't even know what I want to say. I let you down. But it's not my fault.
You haven't let me down, Mom. Don't say
it. You know it's not my fault.
It's not your fault. I know it's not your fault.
Hello?